This is about travel photography. I will tell you about my philosophy, how I define my way of approaching people and working with leading lines and also around colors and stuff like that. So it's a great mix of pictures. So it's more, hopefully, pictures that explain a little bit about my workflow and some pictures that can inspire you or bring you somewhere in your own thoughts with your photography. And for me, travel photography is a question about getting to a place, regardless where you are, and be able to take a good shot, so to speak. So the first slides I'm gonna show you is actually around landscapes, because for me, landscapes photography is my cornerstone, my four cornerstone of all kind of photography. And it's because that in landscape photography, you need to work closely with the object. You need to find the main player and make sure that you have this main player in your frame, so to speak. And at the same time, don't have anything else, or at least not too much, because then you will the focus will disappear. Landscape photography is, as you can see here, it's still, this is in Greenland. The other one was actually from Finland, but here we are in Greenland, and this is exactly how I define all kind of photography, that you need a foreground that would lead you into your main player. In this picture is the ice in the water, is the big icebergs, but the big stones in the foreground would lead us into the main player. And think about this, that whatever you're doing with your camera, it should somehow lead you into the object that you would like to share with us. This one is from Svalbard in Norway, and is also a definition of how you can use the stone in the foreground to lead you into the main player, who is of course this beautiful mountain, as you can see. Color. I think color is always probably the most important for whatever you are doing. And when you do landscape photography, you need to look at the colors. And by looking at colors, you can train yourself and teach yourself how important it is also for your travel photography in general terms. That in this case, you have this green color, you have this stone in the foreground with all those beautiful, almost dramatic colors, I could say, so to speak. And then again, it's built up just as all pictures that I do, actually. It is, I'm trying to work with four corners. I want to have something that leads us in to what we would like to watch. In this situation, it's the water, of course, but also the sky. This is something, this is from Sweden, and it's shot from a helicopter. And I'm showing you this picture because color is so important, as we talked about before. But also be aware about when you go traveling, because all countries have four seasons. In this case, it's the autumn colors in Sweden. And if you go traveling in Asia, you may go there on a period of the year where they have a monsoon, they have a lot of rain, they have stormy weather, they have all kind of weather situation that you can use and add into your pictures. So weather is always something you should look at, and you can plan actually your photography around the color you would like to use in your photography. So now I'm leading us all into travel photography, and from now on it's gonna be around portrait photography, and it's gonna be around my way of approaching people, and also how I define my locations and how I see them. This is from Ethiopia, and this is early in the morning, and the balance in my picture is those three persons on the right side, and then you have the tree on the opposite side, so that brings some balance into the whole scenery. Please ask me questions out there if there is any. This is also from Ethiopia, And this is kind of an opening pictures to the next quite many portraits I will show you all. This is for a bullfight, bull jumping actually, in Ethiopia, and bull jumping is in short terms a question about this guy you can see hanging in the air, that he needs to jump the bulls. And if he can jump the bulls naked, as you can see, then he can marry a girl. If he's not able to jump the bulls, then he's in trouble because he won't have a girlfriend later on that day. So this picture has more than one story from my point of view, because it also tells us something about that it takes a lot of time to take one shot. This shot is this frame is just one time during the whole day you have this chance. And the rest of the day, so many things is going on, but all suddenly this situation starts where the bulls get together, and before you know it, this person, he will jump the bulls. And it goes so fast, and right after this frame, everything's more or less will go apart. People will walk out of your picture, and it's over. So to take situations like this, it could be whatever, it could be a wedding, it could be whatever, it just takes time, and you need to be there, and you need to prepare yourself for the situation. Portrait for me is quite often a definition of the person that you're meeting, regardless where in the world. And I know that quite many will claim that a person always needs to look into your camera, that you like to have this contact between you and the person. But I actually like a lot this kind of portraits where we who will look at the portrait need to concentrate a little bit and give ourselves a little bit of time to actually get to know this person. And in the portrait like this, I think there's a lot of emotional feelings into it, and it's actually growing a little bit since they're not looking at us. Both of those kids here, I met them when I was crossing a mountain together with my driver, and our car broke down, and when they were fixing the car, those kids was just showing up, and I think there was some very beautiful moments to do this very easy photography, this easy portraits. When I'm traveling, I'm trying to optimize my day, so to speak. I'm born hyper. I'm not good just to sit down and know nothing. So I would get up early in the morning, and I would do photography in the low light, and when it's really bright during the midday, and this is regardless where in the world I am, I would go inside. I will go inside a church, monastery, or in this picture here in the next portrait was inside a house. This is, I think it was where the cattle was, and I just went inside, and these people just show up one by one, and I made the portrait. As you can see, it's I'm trying to do it as simple as possible and try to have eye contact. In this portrait and the next one here, you can see that the person is so powerful that it's important for me as a photographer to define the person. So I don't want too much around the person. So we will look at the person, and the person have a story to tell. And again, I actually like this portrait where he's not looking at us. It makes us reflect a little bit about who is that kid, what is it actually. This girl, I wanted her to look at me. I want to have this contact with the girl. And the reason was that I would like to repeat those circles, as you can see. You can see she have all those round white circles in her beautiful face. And I like the eyes around, the black and white, the mouth is round. So I like this repeating those circles. And I would feel that I would lose that how can I put it, that concept in my portrait if she was not looking at us. So think about that. Do you want them to look at you, or do you not want them to look at you? It's a definition that you have to make up yourself. This girl, she was literally carrying this stone on her head. She was working in the fields, and the kids, well, she's probably 10, 11 years old, they're carrying a stone on the head so they're training to keep the balance, to later on in life to balance something on the head. So she showed up with this stone on her head, and she actually wanted to take it off. She said, I'm not looking nice with a stone on my head. And I said, let's do one portrait with the stone, and then I promise you I would do a portrait without the stone. And she had this green leaf that she put on herself, because think about this, these people is living literally in the bush and are so pure. They don't have a nickel. So for her, this is a way to dress up. That's how to go down in the local shop and buy jewelry. That's how she dressed up. As I said before, I'm really a hyper person. So I will work from whenever I go to sleep, before I go to sleep, so to speak, or at least when I wake up. That's the first thing I would do when I'm out there. I would grab my camera and I would do photography. And this was the last shot before I actually went to my tent. I had a little tent in this village in the Omo Valley in Ethiopia. And just before I went to sleep, this boy, he came home with all the cattle. And even the color looks funny, but it's actually due to the high ISO. And it was really dark. But I still think it's a beautiful shot with his movements in the boy. He's moving away with all his cattle. This was early in the morning, probably around 5-6 o'clock. I wake up, and I can really suggest to all of you that to do great photography in the morning, not only because of the light, but actually because people are just like yourself. They will be tired, you know. They don't want to show up for you. And I was just walking around, and almost all the shots I'm going to show you now is from a half an hour where I was walking around this little village. And all the kids would go and make a little fire and sit next to the fire and warm themselves. This little boy, he was sitting inside, starting to cook his food. And I want to admit that I said, "Is that your chicken?" And he said, "Yes." And before I knew about it, he was sitting just as you see it right now. But go inside. This guy, he was walking around also in the morning with all the lambs. And before I knew about it, he was standing with this little one. Again, as I said, this is actually not in the morning. It's midday. I was at a market, and the light was so bright. I couldn't actually do any kind of photography. So I asked my driver, couldn't we go to a tribe somewhere? And he said, "Oh, I know some people living down here." And we went down and we took a walk for half an hour, and I went inside this little house. And there she was sitting with her baby at the fireplace. And for me, that was a beautiful, beautiful situation. And I tried to capture as well as possible. It may look easy, this, but it's actually in a very little room. And you have to find a position where the light gets inside. And don't do photography too difficult. Point and shoot, and that's what happened here. This is also in Omo Valley. And all the kids will dress up when you go there. She would not wear this dress the whole day. It's probably her grandmother who was wearing it when she was younger. And now this girl, she was running around in the village. And for sure she knew that I would take her picture and then make a little bit of money on the side. You may sometimes, when you're traveling, pay the people you're meeting some money to do their portraits. And in Ethiopia, that's actually a way of living in quite many of the villages. And I consider this as a donation, because when you go there and you see how poor people are, then at least what I can do is pay them just a little bit for the work that they're doing. And for us, I mean, it's no nothing, but for them, it's a lot of money. So I gave her a little bit, maybe $1 or what do I know, and I made some shots of her, and I was very happy about this one. Yeah, also from the tribes, as you can see, normally she have this thing in her ear. Here I ask her actually to put her finger, because I want to add it into my story. Very often I do portraits also for, it could be for a travel magazine or for clients. And not all portraits should just be a straightforward portrait. Sometimes you need also to add in a story for the people who's watching it. And here I add in the story about how she could, how big her ear actually is. Again, from the same morning, and you can see her lips. That's, she's supposed to have this plate in her lips. This portrait is the first of a series of portraits I will show you about lightning in general terms. I'm not using a flash. I can remember last time I was using a flash actually. And if I could remember it, it would go more than 25 years back when I had my studio in Copenhagen and I had to use my flash equipment for all kind of photography. Today I'm using light coming from a window, or I'm very often wearing a white shirt. So my shirt can actually reflect a little bit of the light. And if you see in his eyes, you can actually see that he has white spot, and I'm quite sure that's my shirt. So when I go traveling, I have a lot of white shirts. I will put them on and use them as a kind of a reflector. And those who knows me know I'm a kind of a big guy, so I'm a big reflector, so to speak. But beside of that, you have the doorway, you have the windows, as I said before. This is also a portrait taken inside those clay houses. And I guarantee you that is no light at all. This is so dark that you wouldn't believe it. But I would put myself on the side, make sure that we have a little bit of light coming in from a little door. And this light is what I'm working with. In a situation like that, I'm down maybe on a 30th of a second, maybe even way more down, and an opening on 1.2 on my lens. So it's a question about handhold your photo, your camera, and make this guy get some light in his face. Sometimes you meet people the most strange places. This guy I met literally in the bush. He was living in the bush. All suddenly he came out and he walked in my direction, and I just have to take his pictures. I have quite a lot of pictures of him, but this one I like a lot, because as I said before, I don't mind to have eye contact with people. I actually have it on 90% of my portraits. But again, I just want to show you as well that it doesn't matter. Sometimes when you don't have this contact with the person in the lens, you get something else. And I think that I like the way he's looking, and he's like inviting us for a story about him. But I was spending maybe a half an hour together with him, and it was a fantastic morning. And all of a sudden he just disappeared in the bush again, and that was the end of that story. Lighting, back to what we talked about before, bring your portraits in a situation where they get some light. Here the light comes again from the door, and it's just lighting up the person's eyes. This lady looking out, the light is coming in. Here we have the contact between the photographer and the person. And when you do that, I like this straightforward portrait, not too much rock and roll, just we're looking at each other, and that's perfect for me. And lucky me that the light in his eyes really light them up in a beautiful way. And even more lucky for me, it's even sharp. So sometimes you have all the luck. On my way to my driver, this young guy was standing under a tree. Find places where you have some shadows. Let the person be in the shadow, and you will have this beautiful, soft light. Again, this is almost too dark, but even it could be a little bit too dark. I like this. I like dark pictures. I like portraits that's dark, actually. This one as well. She's sitting inside a dark room, and I guarantee you we're down on 1.2, 15 of a second maybe. Yeah. Should we have contact or not? I don't think so. I like this. I like this way that he's just so powerful in this portrait. Again, one of the boys standing, as you can see, this is probably under a tree as well. Again, soft light. I like soft light. I like when you don't have too many strong shadows in the person's face, and it bring our attention to the eyes. And I like that he's holding his hands the way he does, because this is the frame. As I talked about in the beginning of when we're doing landscape, we're talking about the four corners. In a portrait, it's exactly the same. We have the hands is our frame in the bottom, and at the top you have the tree who divides in two directions, and that is our corners. Yeah. Portrait of a guy, also in Ethiopia. They have a tradition in Ethiopia for something called stick fight. And a stick fight is where a person would challenge another person from another tribe, and they will use some long sticks and they will fight each other until they bleed. Quite many of those young guys you will meet in Africa and especially Ethiopia, is missing one eye, and that is actually because of this stick fight. This guy, he was about to have a stick fight, and I made his portrait before the fight, and as I remember, nothing happens to him. Thanks God for that. Water, now I'm going to show you pictures around water, and I'm doing that because when you are traveling and you want to spend the whole day with your camera, you can actually, by being a little bit smart, know where things happen. If there is a river, I would guarantee you, and you're in Africa or in the most of Asia, something would happen around that river. Maybe you need to walk a little bit or drive a little bit, but something would always happen. And this is how it is in Africa as well. And this boy, he was crossing a river with some friends. This is from the Omo River as the backdrop. And quite many of you who have been in Ethiopia have, if not been in this place, but are similar places, because this is probably the most famous place to go and do the portrait of the local tribes around Omo River. It's not a rocket science to do those portraits, because the tribe is there. And what you need to do is of course, be smart and be aware about the weather. And those who have been traveling this part of the world know that late evening, the sky starts to grow pretty much, actually. There's a lot of skies in the evening, and the light is more more soft in the evening as well. So it's about timing. And in this shot, this portrait is probably taking half an hour before it's got too dark. the same day, just in the warm sun, the local kids playing around the river, sitting at the river. You can see out there to the right, there's a rainstorm coming in. And later on, this rain was over the river as well. So look up, see what happenings in the skies. If there is skies, maybe you can be lucky that this will open up or other things. Portrait also from the same area. This boy, I've met him actually more than once. I've been here 3 times, I think. And this portrait is probably the first time I went there. I think it's the same boy, isn't it? I'm not sure. Anyhow, that's also from that tribe. Again, I like to go close. I like to frame it. And as said before, the four corners is in place. If from my point of view, we have his body and the tree in the bottom, the two corners. Up in the right corner, we have the tree as a corner. And on the other side, you have some leaves for another tree. This is another shot from Omo, from the river. And this is a few years old picture, actually. But this illustrates pretty okay that wait for the sun to come up. And if I was a little bit stronger with my post-production, I could do quite a lot more with that sky. But just enjoy it and make sure when you go traveling that be aware about that things will happen during the day. And if they don't have a weather cast, then download an app so you know something about the weather. I'm going to show you some portraits around how you can frame them around trees. If I go somewhere and there's no nothing that I can use as a frame, then I always try to use at least a tree, because I think tree is something that can add a lot into your portrait photography. The tree has a shape, and if the woman, like you can see here, is leaning up of the tree, all suddenly she more or less would be a part of the tree, and we have a frame as well. This boy standing, this guy. It's a bit dark, but that's how it is. When I did this portrait, I remember that it was important for me that his body shape should somehow reflect the trees in the background. So that was my concept, so to speak. I was waiting to this guy. He was standing in a way that he was, yeah, maybe this is too much philosophy, but he's almost growing up just like one of those trees we can see in the background. And I like the portrait a lot. So when we do our photography, when we meet people, should they always be looking at us? Should we always shoot them straight from the front? I don't think so. I think a lot of things happening actually when you see something from behind. This woman, if I don't know how the resolution, the quality is on your laptop, but maybe you can see on her back that she has a lot of scars. Those scars is from what we saw in the beginning, a bull jump. It's very common in Ethiopia and other places in Africa that during the day when you have a bull jump, then the girls would actually be ripped with a string, and they're bleeding a lot. And that's what you can see. You can see the R from that ceremony. And you could also see that her decoration is small keys. If you look down, you can see the small keys hanging down there. And it tells us something about that this is, as we talked about, this is not rich people. This is as best as they can do to dress up. But beside that, a beautiful woman standing on her way to her house in a tribe. Fun, why not? If the situation is there, why not just take a funny picture once in a while? I was driving more or less for a whole day together with my driver and a local guide to meet a tribe just on the border to Kenya. And we was driving, as I said, for the most of the day, and it was so damn hot, and I wasn't feeling that well, actually. And then we got to this tribe, and I wasn't really up to any kind of photography. But all suddenly, this beautiful woman who was pregnant, she walked by me. And I just had to do her portrait. And I think it's such a beautiful portrait of a pregnant woman. And it makes me happy each time I see it. And lucky me, there was a white background to you. So that was really something that I could use so I could bring her out to all of us. Yeah, look down. As you can see, that's what I did. This little kid is taking a nap. And this is how it is most of the places in Africa. Background. I'm always looking for background when I'm at any place, so to speak. In here, it was a little village, and this clay background was pretty cool and was useful for me and to capture this portrait. This boy, all of a sudden, he climbed up there. Normally, people could think, wow, you know, did you ask him to go up there? And I wish I could claim that I did, but I didn't. He was standing actually there, and I think it's his sister's shirt he's wearing. But that's, again, try to use a background like this. If you're lucky, like I was that morning, the stone and the green vegetation adds a lot into a portrait. Yeah, sometimes they're not too happy when you're walking around with your camera, and that's where you can do portraits like that. Do you want to add a story into your portrait? Why not? If you are in a situation as I was with this boy, I asked him, what do you have? What is that? And he showed me this beautiful picture of Jesus, and then when he showed it to me, I made the portrait. And you know, inspiration for all of you who travel or do portraits, you can add small stories into your portrait. Frame, you can use everything. When you're doing a portrait, you can use a frame. In this case, it's a window that the person is standing inside the window. It could be whatever. It could be a door, it could be a wall, it could be whatever. But try always to think about a frame. And as we talked about in the beginning, you have the four corners. You have nothing really that destroys you. You look straight to the guy. The attention will go to the person in your picture when you don't have too many things to take away your attention. Again, out of the village, this boy was standing somewhere playing around, and he ended up over there. And also, you have the door as a backdrop, and very classic portrait. Yeah, I like those colors. I could spend a whole day just taking pictures around this house. It's somewhere in Ethiopia, I don't remember where, but you have those very colorful houses, and you have the windows that is just as colorful, and then you have the local women working in the market. And I asked this woman if I could do her portrait, and lucky me, she said yes. You can see she has this thing around her neck, and that tells us that she's married to one man. If you have two, then it's two, and so on. And it's very normal actually to be wife number two or three in most of Africa. One of the guys dressed up for rock and roll. Again, colorful background is nice. I like the open window. I was happy about it was open because it's opened up our story. So now we have a portrait, and he's not in conflict with the window, so to speak. You can see he's framed on the wall. But an open window somehow lead our fantasy to lead us into that room. What is inside? What is it? What could it be? So an open window for me, this is my definition of photography, is something that can open, that brings us somewhere else in the portrait. Color, when you see people that you think, wow, he's beautiful, or he has something special, just point the camera and do your portrait. The women as well, somewhere on the street for years back that your landscape photography can lead you into your travel photography in general terms. And here I actually made a kind of a landscape for shot definition of this place. And I was just waiting for somebody to walk into this picture. And lucky me, this woman, she was walking home with her thing on her back. So we start to talk a little bit about how you can use landscape photography and how you can add it in general terms. Now I'm gonna bring it to Asia. And this is from Thailand. This is old shot. This is maybe 30 years ago. And I found it for a few weeks ago and I scanned it on my scanner. And I'm just showing this because when you go to a country, you should somehow define which story you would like to tell. And I remember that since I've been in Thailand many times, also before I was taking pictures, I had a hard time to get inspiration actually in Thailand because I was thinking I've seen it all. But all suddenly I tried to go inside those places where the monks were sending letters to the family. And this was just a portrait from one of those places. And then some other portraits around Thailand and the monks. I think it's pretty cool if you can repeat your story. Here those two kids was hanging out and this is probably their mentor. He was walking out and I said, why don't you just stand here for a second? And all suddenly we have some leading lines and we have some corners as well that's leading us into the main player who is our person in the middle. Yeah, also Thailand, why not? If there is a broken window, stand there, wait. At some time, I guarantee you, somebody will stop up and look through the window because that's just how we are as human beings. If you feel there's something inside a house or behind a window as it was here, then you will walk over and look in. Another portrait, mostly just to show that you can, if you like, you can go very close as well. I actually think this is too much. This is too brutal. Actually, I think that I'm not too happy about my own portrait here, but just to show you that a lot of things happens if you go very close. And also if you frame it as I did here, you cut something off his head, then you're really leading everything into his face. And if I should be happy about anything, then it should be the boy in the background looking out. It's a little bit like we talked about before, this have an open window, that this guy in the background make us think a little bit about what is going on here. Where did his thoughts went to? To keep myself busy, I always have some concepts that I'm working on regardless where I am. And one thing is tattoos. I like to, if people have a tattoo somewhere when I'm traveling, I'm doing a portrait of them. And I'm telling you this because this is a good way to keep yourself busy. If it could be food photography, it could be flower photography, it could be whatever, but you can have actually many kinds of things that you would like to shoot during a day. And then also you can actually take pictures regardless where you are. Here is tattoos. This is a fisherman somewhere. This is a local monk. This is also a monk somewhere in Thailand. And then the last shot from Thailand it's a question about how do you define a given situation or a person. In this case, it's one of those long neck women that you probably have heard about. And this was, I thought it was a bit more cool just to show this part of her neck and her lips, and that was it. Of course, I did other portraits, but just as an example, that you as a photographer or artist, you can define actually what you would like to capture when you are shooting. Yeah. This is about Another thing, I like to take pictures of all kind of strange food. I have to say so, strange food. I've done that since God knows when. And now I'm just going to show you some few shots around my definition of funny food where I am. This is from the river of in some river delta in I think it's North Thailand or it's somewhere in that area. A long story short, this kid was in the sand finding those small things, and they will take them and bring them home and cook them and eat them. This is from a market where you can buy scorpions, all kind of scorpions, and whatever you can see on this picture. Some is alive, other one is dead, and some is kind of spicy. This is a dress. This is a plate with spider, big black spiders, deep fried, of course, with some garlic and some spices. And don't ask if I have tried to eat it because I did not do it. But next time maybe. Yeah. Grasshoppers that I think actually was alive, and I think you will grab them and then they will fry them right after. Fish, believe it or not, this is in Norway. This is up at Lofoten where they're hanging out fish heads for the Chinese market. They will hang them outside and they will hang there for 2-3 months. And then it smells pretty bad actually, but it's in the wintertime where it's very dry. And then they ship them to, I think it's China somewhere or Africa. Talking about Corona, the next shots, portraits are from China. This is the bellboy of one of my hotels. It's not a super portrait, but I always push myself to do a portrait if I can feel that I need to kickstart myself. I'm not into the zone, so to speak. Then I would take up my camera, and if I see somebody I think that has a face, then I would just take his portrait. And that's why I'm showing you this portrait, that there was actually just, for me, a question about starting my day to do something. And there was my bellboy. Frame, when you're walking around, this is also in China. This is up in almost up in the corner to Pakistan. Try to find funny situations where there's a person inside a place like here, and wait for the guy to walk into the frame. Also China, he's running his little shop. Have him standing there. I like it a lot, the open door. Lead us into the person, and then we have the flagon, who tells us where in the world we are. Again, China, same place actually. It's the same day I made those portraits. If you have a backdrop like this guy, he had at his shop. It's just a question to sit down and then do his portrait. I like that, things like that a lot. People can also be happy people, and this is a Muslim in China, and it was outside his mosque, and this is just to show you that I don't have that many smiling portraits, but why not? He was happy, I was happy, so why not share a great moment for both of us? Go inside when the light is bright. That is, this portrait is all about. I went inside this Chinese market, and I'll find a place where I really liked the background. And then I was literally just standing there, and when people was walking by, I made the portraits. I said, hey, can I take a picture? And they said, yes. And somebody was just looking at me like this guy. He actually stand up, and then I just made the portrait. But find a cool background. Find a place with photogenic people, and they will walk into your frame sooner or later. Chinese boy working at a bakery. This is on the border to Pakistan, a little Chinese village we went through. I was running a workshop, and it was called on the Silk Road. And the Silk Road, as you probably know, goes the whole way through China and actually onto the border of Pakistan. And from Pakistan, they only go the whole way to Turkey as well. And we stopped our journey on the border to Pakistan. And this guy, he showed up to a wedding we went to, and I thought he was such a cool guy. I thought, my God, he could have been from Marseille in French. He could be my neighbor where I'm from. I like his way of looking at me. Yeah, happy faces, why not? Faces where you get emotional feelings. This old guy, he was standing in the window. And again, get the light, his mustache. And again, it's a religion, if you like them to look at you or not. As you can see, I not always want people to look in the lens, but that's my way of approaching people. This is also from the same area. Those guys were hanging out in the evening. I just thought they were some cool guys. And for me, it's important that there's a balance in your portraits. And I was waiting for this guy in the background to stand up. He was all sitting down the most of the time, but all of a sudden he stand up, and all suddenly you have balance in your portrait. Yes, I'll go on here. Now we're in Bhutan. This guy here had two different colorful eyes. That's why I made his portrait. I like that, actually, that you have this, you have a face, and sometimes the eyes have different kind of colors. So there was from a guy in Bhutan. The same place, I was walking on the street, and all of a sudden this monk, he was looking at me, and the window was so beautiful, and so was the monk. We're in Burma now. I've been in Burma quite many times, and I have to admit that I have a lot of stuff from Burma, but I just nailed it down to very few shots. And just to illustrate a little bit that it doesn't matter if a person walks in your direction or out of a picture in this situation, the person is walking into a place where you have a Buddha statue. I think it's sometimes important for you to spoil yourself with picture like that. Yeah, this guy, he's running his little shop in Mandalay, where you can go and he will read your hands. And I dropped by his shop when he was asleep, and I like those kind of shots. This is a guy working in a shop where they do handcraft, and the back door is actually to his toilet. But I like the colorful background in this portrait of him. This is an illustration about if you have a very, very busy picture. In this case, it's a monastery. You can put your long lens on your camera and you can wait for somebody to show up in your picture. Sooner or later, people would always show up. And in this case, I just had to wait a little bit for this guy to walk into the picture. And he was even standing there and taking a break. Also in Bagan, Burma, I was walking, this guy, he came by, he was walking with his cattle, and I thought it was such a beautiful portrait of this guy just standing there. This is from Inlake in the morning, where we had some local fishermen to show up for us, and we could do some photography around them. And it was, this shot is a few years old, and it was really, really in the very beginning of the morning, so it's very grainy, but I still think it's pretty okay for me. I like to go inside, as I have said a few times. This is an older home in outside Mandalay, and in this big room, all the old people living together, and I was just spending a little bit of time doing the portraits. It's not because the portraits is something very strong, powerful portrait, but sometimes you should just do portraits so you have a story to tell when you get home. And in this case, it's about those old people living there. This guy walked outside. I did his portrait. Before I knew about it, another guy, he put his hand on his shoulder. This is from India. Some illustration about how you can use windows when you're framing. I like the way that we have this lady sitting down in the picture and the other one we have contact through the window. Just to let you know that you can use windows in many different kind of situations and you can get a lot of nice stuff out of that. Yeah, eye contact or not. This guy was also from India. I was walking in a little village and this guy, he came to me and he forced me to take his portrait. And I wish that I could show you all the details because there's so many details in his hair, from small flowers falling down from a tree and so on. It's actually a very, very nice portrait of him. Now we are leaving India. Now we are going to Kathmandu. It's Kathmandu. You can see in the background, Kathmandu is the capital of Nepal. And this is from a monastery early in the morning. And this monk, he I think it's around 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. I think the light is just rising out there over the village. Also from Kathmandu, a lady working in a shop. From one of the monasteries, this older man, he was taking a walk with his family. And all of a sudden he was standing there in the front of me. And I love this beautiful face and his hands as well. When you're doing portraits, you may sometime be in a situation where you will need to make up your mind. Do you want to have this and this in your portrait or not? As you probably have seen so far, I like to do it as simple as possible so I get the person as strong as possible. And when you have such a strong face and you also have the hands, for me, it was important to have both in the portrait. You have a bunch of holy men in Kathmandu. They will ask you to take the portrait and then afterwards they will actually ask you for some money. And what the heck, as I said before, I consider it's a kind of a donation. This holy man, he was sitting and I made this portrait of him. Is another holy man inside Kathmandu. I walked by him and he had a very nice, strong face. Again, make it simple. Don't do it too difficult for yourself. Make sure that the person is looking at you in this situation here. Yeah. I don't know what to say, but yeah, he didn't dress up. That's a holy man. And don't ask me about what the whole story is, but I thought that he was so cool that I had to do this portrait. Another holy man with his long hair. Normally he has his hair put together so you don't actually see how long it is. I asked him, would you mind to show me how long your hair is? And that's why I used his hair as a frame for his shot. So again, as you can see, I like to frame the face as best as possible in a kind of a frame. In this portrait, I used the hair as a frame. And then he was looking at me with those wild eyes. This is up in Tibet. This is from Lhasa. And this is a tradition in the morning. People are extremely religious. In the morning, they will actually spend a few hours praying and then they fall down on their knees and stand up again. And that will go on the whole morning. Then there's some places around Lhasa where they're meeting, the people are meeting and praying, as you can see here. Again, if you don't have any light, find a place where the light comes. And since I knew people would walk over here and it was so dark, I said, okay, cool, Christian, you go here and you wait for people to show up. And yeah, lucky me. luck is also a big player when you're traveling and doing photography. We were a group last year traveling in Tibet, and all suddenly our guide, he said, I know a cool place, let's go there. That could be some people that you may not have seen before, and lucky us, here's one of them. He was a local farmer, and that day when we went there, they had a kind of a celebration where they had dressed up with that mask you can see, and they was playing a play for the other people in the village. And we went inside this room, and we were four or five together who made portraits of this guy, and I'm pretty happy about this one. Also Tibet, inside a kind of a restaurant, not a restaurant, we see them in the most of the world. It's a very simple place where they do yak soup that is very tasteful, and local people will show up and have their lunch or breakfast. This guy, he was sitting next to me and I liked this strong face, so I made the portrait in that room. I think this is the last picture, and this should just illustrate that photography has to be fun, had to be to capture happy moments from around the world. This guy, he was all over happy, and he had a beautiful day because there was a big celebration in his village in Cambodia, and he was supposed to bring this thing that he's carrying to all the guests, and that's what he did. So this is actually my last words.
I saw that we had one question in the beginning already concerning one of the pictures you showed us. It was okay. Booth jumping in Ethiopia. And the question was if you asked the locals to jump the bull or if you just happened to be there.
Oh my God, I happened to be there. They don't jump a bull in Ethiopia just to jump it. It's a big, big thing. It's a ceremony who starts early in the morning and it goes on maybe for 10, 12 hours. And it's the whole village and the neighbor village who will join in. And there will be maybe around 200-300 people, and they will eat and they will drink and they will, it's a whole day ceremony. I don't think that you can buy a bull jump at all, actually. I have never heard about it, actually. But I mean, maybe if you're traveling for National Geographic TV station, you can buy everything, but normal people like us, we cannot afford that. No. So the question is, no, it was not something made up for me or for us. I don't see the chats actually, but okay. So if there's other.
We have more questions.
Okay,
so there is another one. I noticed that the aspect ratio of some of your pictures is not the original one. How do you feel about cropping the images for the storytelling purpose?
I never actually crop my pictures. What I do is I'm doing very low end post production because I'm not very good at it actually, and my philosophy is to try to to work simple, and that's what I'm doing. But cropping, it happens almost never for me, actually. I'm trying to crop it when I'm shooting. It may have something to do that my background is, I was working as a photographer for almost 5 years as a news on a newspaper. And there you normally don't crop your pictures, and you do your own stuff in the dark room. And this is way back where you did analog photography. So you actually had a dark room where you would do in the old day, your post-production. And that is how I do today as well. I do it very simple for myself. And sometimes I'm just playing around, especially if it's some of the landscapes, then sometimes I tend to put too much color, but for me, I'm easygoing about it.
Okay, yeah. Then there's one more. Are you having an interpreter with you? Eye in Africa, or is it only eye to eye communication?
Eye to eye. I don't. When I'm doing my portraits, it's very often a body language between me and the person if I walk inside a place where there's a lot of people, and because I'm actually such a big guy, they see me right away. Sometimes I wish I was a little guy because that could make life easier for me. But anyhow, so when I go into a room, people very often see, oh, wow, that's somebody's walking in to this place. But then I can feel right away. I have this, I'm born, I have this my whole life, actually. I can feel right away if I'm welcome or not. And if there's just this smallest chance that I'm not welcome, I will always just walk out. But if I feel that this is okay, then I will hang around. And if there's a person that I would like to make his portrait or her portrait, I'm just will move in that direction, and then I can feel if the person like it or not. So I cannot speak. I only speak some poor English, and the rest is Danish.
Okay, and then we have a follow-up question.
Yeah.
Is it right to conclude that you generally ask for permission before you take a portrait?
Yeah. Because that's the whole thing when you do a portrait. As I see it, it is that if the person that you would like to in a portrait doesn't want to be in a portrait, then you really have to respect it. I could never ever hide my camera or any stupid things like that and taking pictures. I don't do that. I remember it was really cool when I was young, working for a newspaper, that all the guys would hide the camera inside the jacket and then shoot out from the jacket. And I never understood that, and I still don't. I think that we really have to pay a lot of respect to each other.
How do you make sure that those everyday scenes don't look too staged if people notice that you are taking their photo?
That's a good question. When we go through my pictures, you can see some of them is very staged. You can see if I'm sitting inside with some of the person that the whole situation is a kind of a setup, so to speak. But for sure, I try as best I can to find a situation that create the picture for me. Like the morning pictures I showed you from Ethiopia, it's so wonderful just to walk around very early in the morning because you have all those very unique situations.
If there aren't any more questions, is there anything you would like to mention, Christian?
No, except that it was really, really wonderful to share this moment with you, and I hope that it make a little kind of sense for the most of you.